All right, everybody, welcome back to the Ridgeline Hunting Podcast, brought to you by Phelps Game Calls, professional-grade game calls made for every hunter.
If you're trying to get close with elk, turkey, predators, or waterfowl, Phelps has you covered.
That's right, so go to PhelpsGameCalls.com. Get them close. All right, man. We're back again.
In the flesh, baby.
So today we're going to talk about your goose hunt that you had. What was that, last weekend?
It was like a week and a half, I think, but, you know, relatively not that long ago. It was a really good trip. It's my only designated goose trip I've ever been on, and it was kind of impromptu, so even better yet, I got a call like 3 days before the trip, and someone's like, hey, I have an opening. I was like, sweet, I'm on it. What time do I need to be there?
Yeah, and it was fairly local.
Yeah, close, so... Yeah, there was local, so they said, meet at 6 a.m. And I was like, okay, do the quick math. I was like, okay, I could leave my house at 5:50. That was nice. I was like, damn, that's right around the corner.
Yeah, that's pretty sweet. I didn't even know that you were going. That's how impromptu it was. Mm-hmm. All I got was a picture of all these dead geese, like, all over the place. I'm like, holy crap, what the hell are you doing? Yeah.
It was fun. I had been talking to this guy about hunting with him for a while, and last year, he has a lease he's had for 17 years, and so last year he's like, "Yeah, I'll take you on the spot." And so I was hitting him up, and he's like, "Dude, there's no geese here. Like, they just, I don't know if they're just flying by or what was going on." But this year he hit me up right away. He's like, "We had a 6-man limit last Saturday. You want to come out the day after tomorrow?" And I was like, I check my schedule, but, you know, I just cleared the books and was gone.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. That is really cool.
So I backseated pretty much everything and just went, man. It was one of those times. My wife was out of town too. She was down in Florida with your wife, actually. And
yeah.
So when I, when we got over there, you know, my mom was helping me out with the kids, you know? And so I was like, I'm going to be done. I had a meeting like at noon for a pre-construction job walk meeting thing. And I was like, oh, shit. You know, I was risking it. It was all on the line. And so a fairly official meeting that I put up in the air based on this hunt. And we got there early in the morning. Let me rewind, you know, 10 minutes or so. I got to the spot where they said to meet. And there's this truck there that had like a light bar on the top, like a cop, like a game warden truck. Like, sons of bitches. They already got us. Like, we even got to the field yet. They're checking people for licenses and stuff. You know, so I just drove by. You know, I thought it was a warden. It wasn't the warden. It was just another guy hunting with us that had a truck like that, you know.
Yeah.
Dad gum.
That's funny.
I wasn't going to admit immediate association by pulling up there. Nope, not going to have them check me out. So, we went there, met up, went to the spot. Set up the layout blinds and everything's done in the dark. And we probably had, I don't know, 60 goose decoys and another, I don't know, 50 to 80 duck decoys on the sides.
So you're hunting both? Mallards or?
Oh, there was mallards there. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, we took a couple mallards and then there was some other birds flying around, but they, you know, they're super fast. Some were flying in the nighttime, you know, before shooting light. So you just hear them flying by.
Yeah.
Zipping. Bombers. Shoo,
yeah.
Shoo. You're like, oh, shit, shit. Get in the ground plane. Cover up. You know, the dog jumps in his little. Now, this is cool, too, because they had a cool dog, a little black lab named Millie. Mm-hmm. And this dog was probably, she's probably 45, 50 pounds, you know, not full grown. I think she's like a year and a half or 2 years old. But she left her heart on the playing field. I mean, she didn't leave nothing to it. I mean, these geese were probably, you know, if I had to guess, 10 to 15 pound birds, you know, good sized birds. And so she was having a little trouble grappling them, but she would come bring them in by a wing backwards if she had to. I mean, there was no stopping her. I mean, she was on it. The cool part about it, she was super disciplined. So when we had multiple flights coming in, mm-hmm. like a flight would come in, she'd stay in the box. And we'd shoot, boom, boom, and, you know, she would just be coming out of there. I mean, going after those geese, and more would be coming. So they'd be on the ground doing their thing. And the handler, the owner, he would say, Millie, box. She would just right back in that box and wait. The duck geese would come in, boom, boom. Now it's cleanup time because, I mean, it was, you know, we didn't have them coming in like row after row after row, like waves, but they were coming in multiple sets at a time. And so it was cool to see her work. And that was really, I really got a heightened sense of enjoyment of why people like working with dogs so much. You know, the dog working those birds and bringing them in, it was really good to see. And bring them back to the person that shoots them too. You know, like she would carry.
Oh, that's impressive.
Oh, it was, yeah, it was cool. Like I was like, this is kind of a trip. And she would bring the bird in and they're like, no, Millie, down too. And she'd bring it over to two layout blinds and bring it to you and set it in your lap. As soon as you touched it, letting it go. I mean, it was great. So
yeah, actually, if you want to see Millie bringing in, well, that was a mallard to you, right? I think it was.
Yeah, I had shot a hen mallard. I think we took 6 or 7 ducks that day, all mallards. And so I shot a hen. She brought it right to me. They told her, you know, down 3 because I was kind of in the middle, and brought it over to me, and that was that, man. She let it go over to my hand. She did try to give it a little goodbye kiss, but I was like, eh.
Well, you can see that on our Instagram. Yeah, the Ridgeline Hunting Podcast on Instagram. You can see that. Dave posted those up, actually, I think the next day or the same day when you went on that hunt, and all the other photos that go with that too. So it was a pretty cool hunt to see. And yeah, hopefully I can get an invite to something like that at some point.
Oh, there's already an invite. We just have to have the opportunity. You know, it's this to me was not something where I had any sort of say in what was happening.
Oh, no. I'm just saying, just in general, that'd be cool. I've never been like invited to do anything like that.
See them decoys right behind you, Dave?
Yeah.
That's your invite right there. Just got to get my boat back.
Boat in the water.
Yeah, I got to get my boat back from my buddy's house. So I'm working on doing that because I got a storage issue going on here. But I really enjoy. I've talked about it several times throughout the podcast series. I enjoy duck hunting and goose hunting, pretty much any hunting, and I always look forward to my next hunt. You know, it's not. There's never like a dull moment. There's times where I feel like I don't get out enough, or I'm not being able to get out enough.
That's where I'm at right now.
Dude, those are like. It's kind of like stringing it together, you know. It's like baseball. You know, the batting average is, you know, they're batting 250, and that's like not even a third of the time you get out when you want to and do something you want to do. But when you do, it's like, you know, it's a base hit, you know, or it's a home run, or, you know, something good happens. And so the average, you know, average wise, I'd like to get out multiple times per month during duck season. Multiple days in a row is not a problem over the course of like one little stretch.
Yeah.
But weekend after weekend, you know, Monday through Friday job, you know, weekend after weekend, it's hard to do sometimes because all the other obligations in real life, you know.
Yeah, it's family. When you're a family man, it's not that easy. Sometimes, you know, there's a lot of people that can do that. But I like to keep my wife happy, and I like to be in my kids' life.
Yeah, so right. Well, you got sports. I mean,
yeah, soccer and now that's
just ending, you know.
Football just stopped. And so I had a multi-season deer tag. Wasn't able to go during rifle or muzzleloader or any of that because football obligations. And I'm going to watch my son play PLP high school football. That's where I played. And, you know, watching him play is just kind of surreal, man. It was weird. It was actually kind of weird for me. Susie's still walking around. So Coach Susie was my defensive coach when I was in high school. And he's still walking around out there doing his thing. He's like the... what is he now? He's a like sports coordinator or something like that.
Athletic director, I think.
Yeah, there you go. For Puyallup High School. So actually, he pulled me aside. I was like, "Is that your boy out there? I see that name running around." I was like, "Yeah, that's him, man." So it was just weird.
Yeah,
weird, you know, 22 years later, you know, it's just weird.
Yeah. So family obligations. Not to get too off track here, but
yeah.
I used to fish a lot. I mean, there's people say I forgot more than I know about fishing now or hunting now or whatever now. I actually did. I'm sitting there going, man, I used to fish so much. We get way in the weeds. We could get so far in the weeds with fishing. In the Northwest, we have steelhead and salmon. I was a huge steelhead fisherman. I would travel, you know, basically from Canada to Oregon in a day to find a river that was in good shape to fish. Because, you know, back in those times, we didn't have like a pocket internet. You couldn't look at the water, water flows. You could look at them when you're at home, but
yeah,
and then change overnight, you know,
then there's no like, Google Maps.
Yeah.
So you had to download, like take a left, you know, on blah, blah, blah. Yeah. And you had to have like 18 pages of like where you're going. Like, holy crap. Are we into the next page yet? Cause
the funniest thing about that whole thing with the MapQuest, we would go towards the river. So like, I know the river's this way, you know, we don't know where the public launch is. We don't know where the fishing access is. We just know the river's up north. Right. So we'd head that way and we'd hit every gas station. Hey, do you know where this river's at? We're trying to find this river. So we would travel around that way. And that's how we found Winston.
Oh,
so okay. Back in the day, I think this was like 2000. No, it was before that. It's probably
saying back in the day, man. Like that,
1999. It was 1999, I think, or 1998. I was still in high school.
That's so weird, though.
It is
back in the day.
Back in the day. You know, when we were trying to find the areas, there wasn't like a map, you know?
You had a
map book you could do. Thomas Guide or something, but it was a trip. And so we met this old guy at a gas station, and he looks at us. We're in camouflage. It's probably like 10:30 in the morning. He's like, what the hell are you boys doing over here? And we're like, oh, we're going elk hunting. He's like, well, you're in the wrong spot for that. You need to go down the road here, go down, take a left on this road and go back to the woods, take a right on this road. And then you should be right in him right then. We took a mental note. We were going to ask him for directions twice, you know, took a mental note. We're like, okay, where are we going? Oh yeah. I think we said something like this. Sound like Stin. Oh, here's a road that sounds like Stin. Go down this road, go over here. What do you say, 400, 500? What the number was that? What, you know? Oh, here's a road right here. We took a right there. Elk were crossing in the rearview mirror, man. It was like, it was on fire. Funny. That was the heydays. And that's how we found that spot.
That's crazy.
Because of a guy at a gas station, you know? So, yeah, but family priorities, man. I used to fish a ton, way more than I do now. I used to have a jet sled. I used to run the boat, you know, constantly. When I was dating my wife, you know, I would take her and her dad out. I deckhanded for a guide for 2 years. That's volunteer work, by the way, tip work, basically. But the cool thing is he's like, hey, I'll teach you how to fish. You'll be able to go out and fish for free. Just help them keep their lines in the water. And then you get tips. So you're fishing for free on a guide boat.
Yeah.
And you get to use his equipment, all his bait. You learn how to do it. And then you get tips and you get like 100, 125 bucks a day in tips. But you're fishing too, you know, so you're getting paid for fishing. So not a professional, but hey, I did make some money and I was single.
I failed this year at guiding for sure. If you want to call it guiding, but you know, took Devin out turkey hunting, skunked, take Mike out. First time ever hunting deer and elk. We didn't see anything. Bad year for me. Bad year for Dave Crane here.
That happens, man.
So bad. We didn't see one elk. And I'm like hyping the spot up, you know, like, dude, last year it was on fire. Freaking, it was insane. It's going to be nuts. Get out there. Couldn't even hear the crickets going.
Couldn't hear the crickets. We didn't even see a bug.
Well, we saw those. Yeah. I mean, there was flies trying to land on our eyeballs and stuff. But
yeah.
So how was the weather when you were out? Goose hunting, because I mean, you know, we're here in the, you know, Washington State, and the weather has been like super mild. We have our rains, you know, but
you wish for though, Dave. You know, you know. So,
well, this weekend was fantastic.
Yeah,
the only thing that we could hunt right now is bear.
But so fantastic in the Northwest is anything that doesn't have rain above 40 degrees. In a lot of places, you know, that's not. You know, people are going to listen and go, that's not fantastic. But here, if you're not soaking wet in 40 degrees or colder,
yeah,
pretty good. Right now, we're in kind of a clear sky little phase where today was super sunny. It probably got to like 45 degrees in the high. But this morning, it was like 29.
Yeah, it was cold.
Yeah. So, you know, when it's clear skies here in the winter, it's usually pretty cold. But that weekend, we went goose hunting 2 days before. I mean, we had tremendous amount of rain. The rivers were blown out. You know, total fishing was shut down on the rivers for, you know, the silvers and steelhead. There was nothing going on. Everybody's checking for a river. And we were anticipating a severe amount of rain. And I don't know what happened, but it was clear. I mean, there was a little tiny high overcast, not even enough to block the sun. And so about 10 a.m., the sun got over the tree line. And it was actually fairly warm when you're in the direct sunlight, but it was still cold with the breeze. So when you're sitting there and the sun's beating on you like a window, you're like, oh, this is nice and warm. But if the wind blew on your face, you're like, oh, it's actually pretty cold out here. so lucky for us.
Had that nice, crisp morning.
Yeah, it was 41 degrees, 41 and sunny. But the morning time, there was just, you know, broke up clouds, just like you would, you know, expect in the fall, or sorry, in the spring here. And very thin layer. So the geese were in full effect, moving right away. The ducks were coming in. We had a fair amount of migrators. A bunch of lessers came in. And lessers are loiters. They don't come in. They just fly above, circle, 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 squawk, squawk, squawk. They move on. The ones that were coming in were the Canadian, regular Canadian geese.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so they were, them suckers were big, man. Pterodactyl. I mean, they were a bunch of nice birds. In our last set, we had 17 geese in the blinds, and we were trying to get our last three birds, and this big flight came in. We seen them come from way off. They kind of came into our left, circled around behind us, and you know, you don't know if they're going to come down because they all are working as like this little mob, you know. But if one person in the mob decides, I'm going to go start a fight down here, the rest of the mob follows. So this one goose kind of peeled off, and it was like 20 foot of separation between that one goose and the rest. And then it kind of beelined down a little bit, started dropping. Like, oh no. Then all of them started dropping.
Oh, nice.
And it was 100 or 150 geese.
Oh my
God. We needed three and we had five shooters. so it's like, we're talking when they're coming in, we're like, okay, only three. And they're coming in lower and they're dropping. And there's like nice separation between the bottom geese and the top geese. And they actually started getting feet on the ground. We were talking in our little layout blinds. We're like, oh, should we shoot the ones on the ground? They're right. You know, we're like, no, wait, let them separate. And it's like they just spread apart 5-6 feet between them. I don't know how they did it, but we said, take them. And it was boom, boom, boom. I said, that's three, because they just plop, plop, plop. You know, they fell. The ones on the ground took off. The ones in the air took off. And we had 20. And that was the end of that. So it was perfect. I mean, I had a 360 cam up. I wish I'd have got the video right, because I didn't somehow, when I was inside my layout blind, I didn't click it onto 360 mode. I did it originally. So like the first video was on 360. Somehow I fudged the button or touched the screen or something, and it went back into regular camera mode.
Oh.
So I got some video, but it's not, it's just, you know, delete video. It's not anything you want to see. So if I'd had 360 on, that would have been miraculous.
A good one.
See. Oh, dude.
That would have been a good one.
We jumped out high five and, oh man, that was sweet. That was like the best hunt. And the guy we went with, he's like, in 17 years of hunting here, this is the best hunt I've ever had.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's something to say. That's really good.
Well, the weekend before, he had a 6-man limit. So, and he's not a guide. He doesn't charge anything for this. He's just a regular guy here in the community that has a lease and hangs out, and he's building his community and stuff like that. So he's a business guy and he just takes people out and BS in the blind and hunt geese and
just have fun.
Pop birds, man.
Yeah.
It's super fun.
That's cool.
And so he had a 6-man limit the weekend before, and you know, the 5-man limit, he's like, this is the best I've ever had, because it was, everybody had such a good time, and the way it all went down, I mean, we had one goose. He came in by himself. He left by himself after 15 shots.
Oh my gosh.
And I got that on video. I won't show anybody that one, but you see the guy, it's like the goose is flying right broadside and it's like boom, 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 boom. He just still flies off. And the guy's like, I don't know how we missed that bird. And he was, I don't know how far away it was. Didn't seem as far as some we took,
mm-hmm.
But man, Teflon Don, he's gone. You know, like, I couldn't even believe it.
That's funny.
And so that one, after that one, I was like, what size shot you guys using? And they're like, 2-3. One guy had some 4s. And I was like, I'm going to BBs. After the BBs, man, they started dropping, you know?
That's funny. That's crazy how, it, you know, you're switching up your shot, too, mm-hmm. while you're out.
Well, these birds, I mean, you're not trying to shoot them far off. You know, they weren't far off. They're coming in a decoy. So, but I just had questions like, there's no way. I mean, I'm going to the range, shooting skeet. I'm doing 24 out of 25 and it's with the same gun. I don't have a designated skeet gun. So I'm out there shooting that. And,
I'm terrible at that.
Oh,
I'm terrible.
I enjoy. So Sumner Sportsman, we go down there and we'll shoot, probably three rounds and, you know, 23 to 24 a round. And to see a goose, you know, they're not moving like a pigeon and they're way bigger. And I'm sitting here, I'm getting on my bead and everything and everything feels right, but nothing's happening. I was like, there's gotta be something to it. So, I just sized up. You know, which is kind of weird because when you size down in shot numbers, you're sizing up. So it's kind of one of those things. I went to BB's, man, and after that, no problemo.
Nice.
Yeah, it was fun.
Well, everybody limited out, man. So, I mean, it was a good hunt.
Oh, it was super good.
It was done early.
9:30 in the morning,
yeah,
man.
You texted me. I was like, yeah, limited out. Got the photo. I was like, what the heck? But dude, it's still like morning time.
He's like having his first cup of coffee.
I was. Just chilling. I was like, oh crap.
Yeah. I was prepared. That was awesome. I was prepared for a full day and to cancel my meeting. But needless to say, I didn't need to do that, which is good.
That's awesome.
So I'm looking forward to my next one. I'm not sure when I'll be able to head out again. Hopefully soon. I know, you know, we're getting close to Thanksgiving.
Yeah, next week.
Is it 1 week or?
Yeah, next week.
We have a week and a half left.
No, it's not. Yeah. It's not next week. It's the following week after that. Yeah.
So
we're doing this podcast on the 13th.
So the Thanksgiving week, I'm leaving to go mule deer hunting. So
that week? Like the whole week?
No. I'm leaving Friday.
After work or?
I don't work on Friday after Thanksgiving. So
I have to.
I know you got to. But so I have a rule for a company rule. That I think that if we have a holiday like Christmas, Thanksgiving, New Year's, that we should just enjoy our family and our time and then be able to do whatever we want to do on the holiday without having to worry about tomorrow. So then people could just enjoy themselves. So we don't work the day after those holidays or the 4th of July, because sometimes that's in the middle of the week. You know, those days, everybody's barbecuing, having a good time.
Yeah.
You know, and you don't want to be like, make sure you don't go overboard because tomorrow you got to be at work. And it's never really a productive day. You know, it's just kind of like everybody shows up and looks around and wonders if they should be there. So,
yep.
So, yeah. So, I have that policy to where, you know, we don't have to be there the next day. And if somebody wants to work, say if they wanted to work, they could. But most people just opt out. And we do the same thing for the week up to New Year's, between Christmas and New Year's, because it's kind of, you know, customers, they just had, you know, Christmas. We try to organize our jobs based on that schedule. They have family over, they have decorations up, they don't want, you know, all this other intervening things, and they don't want to hurry up and clean up in order for us to go back and, you know, not make a mess, but have construction going on in their home. So I leave it open to the customers at that point if they want us there after Christmas or not. But we try to stay out of people's homes after Christmas till New Year's. And then it's kind of a nice time for us to just reflect and relax too.
But yeah.
You know, a lot of times guys work on commercial or like residential new construction. So we have a fair amount of that. That's all custom stuff. But so, yeah. So I'm going to be the day after Thanksgiving. I'll check and see what's going on with the lodging. But if we can leave here, when will you be back from work?
I'll work from home.
Oh, well.
I'll be off at 4 p.m.
You need a computer to do that? I mean, do you have to be on the computer or you're just on the phone?
Yeah, no. On the computer.
Well, you might be able to do it in the truck. I got a Wi-Fi in the truck.
That would be sick, but I do have to take calls too, though. So,
well, we'll figure something out. If they have a lodging there for us, I know they have lodging for me. But if they have lodging, because we're staying in a wall tent, if they have enough space, I'll check, and we can head out there and do some mule deer hunting.
Yeah, let me know.
Yeah,
yeah, because that's like I think that's the first weekend of late season archery.
And these guys are going on the 20th. So they're going to be there the whole week before.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So they'll be there. These guys have hunted there in this spot for a long time. They have always done well. And they say like the later in the rut, the better. And so I'm hoping to get there. And he's like, you're going to see 30 deer a day. No problem.
I could always see if I can get off early too.
Yeah. If we can head out.
Do that tomorrow.
You know, the earlier the better, just because the drive is substantial.
Well, if it's mule deer, yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, it's in the mountains too. So way north and east of Mike's place.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's going to be.
Dude, you know that there's like 2 feet of snow over there right now, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure. So, I mean, that's the thing. There's going to be a good migration.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah. I've been getting texts from Uncle Mike. So,
yeah,
there's deer everywhere.
Check out my corn. Let the corn stand.
Yeah. He's always sending me something.
So, I'm looking forward to that one. Not sure what to expect because I haven't ever hunted in this area. I've hunted with these guys before. And I told you about the trip that we went on. Where I was up to like 11 at night waiting on them.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, okay. I know who's going.
Yeah. That was wild.
That was a boy.
Yeah. These guys literally jumped off this massive ravine hillside into no man's land and didn't have a radio, GPS, flashlights, their backpacks, nothing. I mean.
Well, that's what you do when you're a kid.
Well,
I mean, they're adults, but.
They're in their
early 30s.
Yeah, early 30s, but I was still. I literally called my wife. I was like, well,
that
I don't
was
know
late. They were probably in their late 20s at that point because this was 3-4 years ago.
Yeah, probably
5 years ago, maybe.
Probably about that. But I literally called my wife. I was like, babe, I don't even know what to do. These guys have been gone for 7 hours, and this is not that big of a place. I can't get a hold of them. I don't know what's going on. So, I mean, at 11 o'clock at night, I saw some movement down the road because they came up way down the road and they were like walking. You could tell they needed water. This is September. So, yeah, that was sketchy. I was like, dude. And they're like, oh, we're going to be okay. I was like, yeah, but I didn't know that. Like, I mean, I'm sitting here like worried what's going on. It's already been dark for 3 hours.
Yeah.
You know,
that's a long time.
You know, so I figured in 3 hours, you could hike up any of those hills in 3 hours, you know, and there's two of them. I was like wondering like what could happen, but yeah, so I'm going hunting with them and, everything turned out good. And I don't know, when I was younger, we did the same thing. I mean, we used to hunt in just like regular old cotton pants from Walmart, little Wrangler camouflage pants and a Ranger camouflage pants and the Ranger t-shirt with a little pocket in the front, short sleeve. I mean, we were, you know, getting killed by everything. And you know, it was just stinging nettles on the arms and bugs on your back. Just, it was brutal.
Yeah. Let me know, man. I'd be down to go.
Yeah. Should be a good trip. They were going to stay in this one lodge. But they ran out of space, so they have a wall tent they're bringing out. There's going to be, I think, three or four guys in the wall tent, so they'll probably have space.
Well, I could always bring the Tent Mahal and put the heater buddy in it.
Tent Mahal, yeah. Well, we can figure something out.
Let me know. I mean, I still have to see what my work schedule is and if I can get off early or not. I don't even know if that can happen. So at that point, I'd probably be out. We'd be leaving hella late, not get in there until super late. It's 6 or 7 hour drive. So
I'm only coming back on Monday or Sunday. So it is what it is. You know, you got to get what you can get. And
yeah, but I mean, a weekend of hunting is better than weekend on the couch.
Got to take that average. You know, we were talking about average earlier, and it's like, you get the time.
You got to go.
A solid day and a half in prime mule deer country during the migration. You take that time.
Yeah. You know? And I'm still trying to work some time out to where I can go and hunt with Kirk over in Arizona. I want to do that. I've been trying to do that for a few years now, and just something always pops up and booger something up. So
I think the hard part with that is it's in January, and like our brain isn't geared to hunt deer in January.
It's like, we just got done.
Yeah. Like it's different.
Got the lows from freaking elk season, man. That was in September.
The lows. Got to get over that, man. Dang. You're like a duck's back, man. Let the water run off.
Keeps me going. Keeps me getting to the next one. I mean, Mike had a good time. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, going way back. He got to draw on two deer, and he almost got it done. I flung an arrow and had a deer and missed, which is very rare. I don't usually miss. So, I mean, we had a good season. It was just the elk season sucked. We didn't see any elk, no matter, like, yeah. So let's go past that. So, you know, we're going to have this mule deer hunt coming up. You know, Dave, you're definitely going to be there. Hopefully I can be there. That'd be fun. And then, you know, that would probably be the season. And then we have the sportsman show coming up.
Yeah,
we're going to have something set up there. We're not going to have like a booth, but we're going to be set up somewhere out there. So anybody that's going to be at the sportsman show here in Puyallup, Washington, come by the booth. We'll be there. We're not going to be there all stinking day because we have regular jobs, but you know, we're going to have something set up and hopefully we'll grab some people and do a podcast or mobile podcast where we're just going to be interviewing folks and just having fun. I think it's going to be cool to have like a presence being at the show. And hopefully I can get a hold of Dirk Durham and maybe we can have some Phelps giveaways and, you know, some other stuff to give away to folks. And
yeah, we'll do something
fun. It's going to be fun.
Yeah, we'll do something fun, and we're gonna be there talking with other outdoors folks and people that are in the industry, and see what we can do. And it's gonna be a good time. I think if we have some sort of scavenger hunt, it'd be fun. You know, we could do something like that. Not where people are running around crazy with little bags like Easter eggs or anything, but you know, just like send us a message on Instagram when you're at the show. Come locate us, and we'll have something. You know. Until we run out of whatever we have.
Yeah.
You know, so it's kind of like a grab bag of sorts. I mean, we're not going to say we have 75 things to give out to people, but we do want to meet the audience. We want to say hi. We want to have people have a good time at the show. I've been going to the sportsman show as long as I can remember. Dave's been going to the sportsman show
since I started hunting, at least.
Yeah. And you know, we're going to spend some time in the fishing section. We're going to spend some time in the hunting section. We're going to talk to bird hunters and all that stuff up there too. So we're going to have a good mix because we don't want to just be focused in on big game, because there's a lot more to the
year. There's so many different avenues of hunting. Actually this year, I'm going to do a lot more predator hunting. I did a little bit of it in this summer and it was on fire. it was so fun. Mm-hmm. I've never really just designated time to just, you know, for bear hunting, except for this year. It was on the hit list. I wanted to get a bear really bad. Well, my bear hunt turned into a coyote hunt, and the coyote hunt was freaking awesome. So I definitely want to, like, I want to transfer into being like more of a predator hunter and start firing my dang rifle, because I don't really shoot my rifle very much. So I want to do that a lot more and get more proficient in shooting that, you know, getting my effective range out further. I think that'd be really good. But yeah, there's a lot more than just big game hunting. There's a lot of different types of styles of hunting out there. And for me, I've never pheasant hunted before. I think that'd be pretty fun. Never done that. I've never duck hunted, never shot any waterfowl ever. The only thing I've shot is turkeys, because they pretty much sit still. So
they weren't sitting still this year.
No, they weren't. They're boogering out really fast.
Full blast, Wiley Coyote running.
Yeah, pterodactyl.
So like all your experiences, when you have like a certain set of experiences and it's just like one way, and we've been accustomed to turkey hunting, and we go out there and we set up our decoys, or we call and they come in, and it seems like it's more of a truncated, easy experience. And this year, you went out with your son.
Yep.
And you guys had some come in, no shot.
No. He had shots.
He missed. Didn't take a shot. He didn't.
No, he missed.
Oh, he took a shot.
Yeah. So we had one where he didn't shoot. Well, okay. It was all in one thing. So we had birds come in. I was like, "Are you on them?" Yeah. Nothing happened, because he could have doubled up on one shot. Mm-hmm. He had two toms. Their heads were pretty much like 3 inches apart from each other, and I didn't know that I had to tell him, like, "Hey, shoot." So I'm waiting, and then they start moving again. I'm like, "Hey, man, you gonna shoot?" And he's like, "Yeah." I was like, "Are you on him?" "Yeah." "Shoot!"
Yeah. Get the birds, man. Put the birds in the freezer.
Yeah, but he missed, and you know, it is what it is. And then we've, you know, have birds coming in. They're just too far out. I couldn't coax them in any further or any closer to us, and it just didn't happen. And then I went by myself a couple times, and that was pretty much the same scenario. They just wouldn't come in close enough, and I wasn't going to take an 80-yard shot on a turkey. If I had my bow, I probably could have nailed a couple of them with my bow.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was it was a good hunt. I had fun.
When we were up there, we had a hard time. Like, we had the birds talking. They were just they were just across the canyon. They were down in the gully. And we even went after them down there. But when we got there, crickets. You know, it was like
nowhere. It was like, where the heck did all these birds go? Because we just had them freaking gobbling all over the place. And then all of a sudden, there's just nothing.
And that one little section where we had, I would like to know how many birds were around us. I mean, it had to have been, I don't know, 25 or 30-ish.
I know that there's a ton of birds. So we hunt a property or an area that's butted up to private.
And it's state land, so anybody can go there.
Anybody can go there. But hey, it butts right up.
Ain't going up that damn hill.
Nah, people ain't going to want to do that. But it butts right up to a section where there's up to 60 birds. And my son and I had them coming in on a conga line, and then all of a sudden, I have video of it. I haven't posted it yet, but I had them coming in, and all of a sudden, it was a hail.
Oh, yeah.
Massive hail. And, you know, I don't even know where they went. It's like they just melted into the ground because we didn't even see them go anywhere. They just, like, disappeared because they're coming straight for us, and all of a sudden, poof, they're gone. Like, what the F?
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, that whole day, we didn't see anything. And then, I mean, dude, I hunted the whole youth season with my son. So, I mean, we'd take Friday off, we'd go for 3 days, and then we did that the whole youth season. So, it was fun, man. He had a good time, and he didn't get to hunt big game this year because of football. And then he basically just told me this year, he was like, Dad, I'm done hunting big game until maybe after college.
Well, we'll have to see about that one.
Well, he wants to focus on football, and I said, you know, hunting is always going to be there for you. And I was like, it'd be nice just to get out and turkey hunt because it's not during the football season, and it's in between their weight training, before the weight training starts. So he was like, yeah, man, I still want to hunt. He was like, I want to focus on football. So,
well, it sounds like a good opportunity to take him down to Arizona in January, you know, when there's no football season.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
You know, then you can go out and do the thing with
him. Yeah, that'd be cool.
I would say after you go and scout it out, you know, and
after I get my feet wet and not.
And you can say, Karen, I'm doing it for Devin.
By a snake.
Yeah, Karen, exactly. Karen, I'm doing it for Devin.
Yeah, Devin needs to go down there. He needs a new bow, too.
Yeah. That's how you do it. You got to work that little tactic in there.
Yeah, that'd be fun. That would be fun.
So finding the little edge to where we can still experience it, but, you know, maybe it's not our traditional season, but you still get the chance. You just might have to travel.
Yeah. And hopefully, for me, it's more like a PTO thing. Hopefully, I can get down there this year. But I had to use up a lot of PTO when Karen was gone and stuff. And then I ended up with COVID. They wouldn't allow me to go to work. I felt fine, but I don't know. There was a couple days where I was like, oh, I feel like crap. I'll take this stupid test thing. And I shouldn't even have done that. I should have just walked in with a mask or something.
They work.
Yeah. So. Yeah, right.
Anyhow.
Whatever.
Yeah, so you got to do what you got to do. You know, figure it out. Get your PTO right or however.
It's just one of those things. I mean, I work for a credit union, and they do a, you know, PTO, and you only get so much the year.
You have also, you know, you have month on month off right now with time off. So if you have that month off in January, and you can go down there and work satellite, because I'm sure they have Wi-Fi in Arizona. You know, so morning hunt.
I'd have to work at Kirk's house.
It's all right. You know, you can figure out the logistics of it. You know, if it's just PTO, you know, like when we go hunting, Luke will bring his computer and he'll spend, you know, an afternoon.
It's a little bit different with him. I have to take phone calls. So not only do I have to be on my computer, but I have to be taking phone calls, which is weak.
Yeah.
Weak sauce. But I mean, it is what it is. I'll figure it out. I mean, if I don't end up going this year, which Kirk's going to probably just be like, hey, man, don't say you're going to come. And then
he's going to just send you a mount. He's like, here's your Arizona deer.
Yeah, exactly. I shot it. But yeah, so we have a lot coming up. We have a lot that we would like to do with this podcast and get out in the community and just, you know, share our experiences and, I mean,
get people involved as well.
Yeah, definitely.
That's going to be fun. I was just, you know, we talked to Kirk last episode and we were talking about turkey hunting, and I have some property we can hunt in Florida for Osceola turkeys, which is,
we need to make that happen. I think we need to make that happen.
Yeah. So getting this Osceola turkey hunt would be completing Kirk's turkey slam.
Yeah, for
North America slam.
Yeah.
So the Osceola bird, you can only get it in Florida below, I think it's Highway 70 South. And it's just basically from Highway 70 South, south to the Everglades. And that's basically the section. You know, we have several hundred acres down there where we can go, and on multiple different plots, our little tracts of land. So it should be good. And they, you know, Florida does a good job with how they have their game management, because they have only so many tags you can have for statewide. Once they reach a quota, they shut down hunting unless you have private property,
which we have access to.
We have access to, yeah. And that would,
when is that hunt? Is it the same as
March?
So it's right before our turkey season starts.
Yep, it's in March.
Ooh.
So it's a good time of year. Plus, you have a good chance of shooting a hog. You know, yeah, there's hogs nice. There, and there's quite a few hogs down there. But the funny part about it, I was just reading these articles about, you know, they have this Florida, they have a problem with these Burmese pythons.
Yeah,
Burmese pythons.
They're paying people to kill them.
They had a roundup. I can't remember the numbers. I think it was, I don't know. I want to say several thousand that they rounded up within 3 or 4 days.
Oh my gosh.
But I was like, damn.
That's a lot of snakes.
It's a lot of big snakes.
That's a lot of boots.
So I got confused for a minute. And they're paying people. So some of these guys are bringing home like a couple grand.
Yeah.
And then so I was reading these articles in Thailand, they had this lady. She was like taking the trash out. She was like 82 years old, grandma. And she didn't come back.
She got eaten?
She got eaten. It was a,
an anaconda?
It was a reticulated boa constrictor, reticulated boa or something. Anyhow, it was 22 feet long.
Oh, hell no.
Yeah.
I'll be messing with no snakes.
It ate her whole, too. I mean, they found her. They found the snake with her whole body. I'm like, I ain't living there. Like, that's crazy. And to think that in Florida, that's, you know, they haven't eaten people, but they found them with deer in there.
They will.
Crazy.
You got some little kid playing around over there. They'll get one.
Well, they're two different snakes, for one. These ones in Thailand, they get massive. They're the biggest snake. And then the ones in Florida, they get huge, too, but they're not as big. So I think, I don't know what they are, 12 or 18 feet, maybe.
I don't know.
A massive one would be 18 feet, but I think the average is like 8 to 12 feet.
I'll mess with those snakes.
Imagine a 22-foot.
Nope.
Look up the article. Let's look up the article real quick. Just because I can't remember the name of the snake. I'm going to look this up real quick.
Well, while Dave's looking that up, we're going to hear from one of our sponsors. This section of the broadcast is brought to you by Burpaw. Burpaw.com.
Use Ridge15 at checkout to receive a sweet discount.
That is a pretty sweet discount. 15% off? Come on. Let's go.
Yep. I get that discount, baby. So this woman was killed and swallowed whole by a 22-foot python. I was totally wrong on her age. She was 54. And it was in Indonesia. And I'm just trying to find the name of the snake. The kind of snake that ate this gal. Click on this thing. Trying to give me more and more.
You just got pop-up, huh?
Yeah, I got pop-up deal. And so... Now this one, it's a python. Trying to find what kind of python it was here. This thing was 7 meters long, and they found her in the python's belly.
7 meters?
Yeah, so
like 21 feet?
22 feet total. And it's not telling me the kind of python, but I'll tell you what, man, if I'm living in a place with 22 feet long pythons, you know what I'm having with me? A little suicide vest. I'm not going to let them take me whole. That's gross.
A vest with like spikes on it or something.
I was thinking like maybe like a leg, like a shin guard, almost like a gator that had razor blades on the outside of it. So when they start to squeeze, it just cuts them in half, you know, something that just like springs open like an umbrella with razor blades on it. That wouldn't be bad. You know, like the sucker tried wrapping me up and it just sprung open and cut it right in half. I think it's an articulated python, but regardless, man, that sucker there, it almost seems like they shouldn't exist.
Well, people probably shouldn't be living there. Just like, you know, Florida's beautiful and everything, but people probably shouldn't live there.
In Florida? I don't know, man. I was down there. It's too nice to not live there. You take the good with the bad, and, you know, the Everglades is in one spot, you know, where they're primarily at. But if you had to go ahead, sorry, it's a reticulated python. They're the longest snakes in the world, some growing as long as 28 feet.
Nope.
Dude, that's like 3 trucks.
Mm-mm.
28 feet. The snakes climb trees. And
all right, everybody, I'm about to tell you guys something. We will hunt Eastern Washington, and there's like this weird bush when you walk. Like, I don't even know what it is. It's like a weird thing of grass. You walk by it, and it sounds like a rattlesnake.
Yeah, I second that.
I start running, like, until I realize it's this stupid little thing. Because there could be rattlesnakes all over the place.
I told you about the rattlesnake I saw over there with Kirk.
Yeah, yeah.
We were spring turkey hunting, and the ground, like, freezes. But there's these little holes in the ground. And for listeners out there, I told Dave the story. But I don't know how I even spotted this thing, because it was a baby. I mean, it was probably as round as your thumb. I mean, that's the diameter of that sucker. And it was curled up in this little hole in the ground. And Kirk was probably 5 or 6 feet in front of me. I was like, Kirk, check this out. He comes over and looks. I was like, is that a snake down there? He goes, I wished you hadn't seen that. Like, literally, like a whole hunt after that was like worried about snakes, you know? Like, damn.
That's the one thing I know that's like going to freak me out when I'm in Arizona. I'm like going to be like watching where I put my hands. Because I don't really wear gloves or nothing, you know? So I don't want to, like, put my hand down and have a freaking snake, like, latch onto it.
Oh, Dave, you wear gloves. You just usually leave them where you take them off.
Yeah, that happens a lot, actually. I had to go back and get a pair.
He's like, those are $70. I ain't leaving those.
Yep. I went back.
So, a little secret about myself. Ever since that day, I spotted that little rattlesnake in the hole. Every time I sit down, I'm looking around for rattlesnakes. Wait,
is this where we go?
Every time we go, when you hear me making a bunch of noise over in a corner or by a tree, I'm like kicking holes and making sure there's no snake, looking up in the branches, checking on the leaves. I'm raking the shit out of that place, man. There's too many snakes around there.
Screw those snakes. I'll blast them.
Yeah.
I don't care. Like, well, we might not see any birds today, but I blasted the snake.
Yeah. I have a buddy who does that. They actually go rattlesnake hunting above Ellensburg.
Oh, my uncle does it in his front porch.
They get quite a few. Kind of crazy, because I was like, I didn't even know there were snakes up there. Yep. I'd hunted there plenty of times, never
heard shot in his revolver.
Blam! Yeah. Yep.
Right, everybody. That's going to be the podcast for tonight.
I think we've covered so many bases tonight. It's just, it's flown by. It's, you know, we've almost got an hour in here. And, you know, the snake thing is always a concern, but it's always in the back of my mind.
I don't like no dang snakes.
And I'm happy, happy that we don't live in a place where there are reticulated pythons.
No. Yeah.
This lady.
Be lucky.
She was taking out the trash, man. And it wrapped her up and gone.
Imagine getting your mail.
Yeah. And
running from something.
Well, Alaska's got bears. They got, you know, stuff to watch for. You know, wherever you're at, you got to look and be cognizant of where you're at. Speaking of that, we're going to have a guest up on our next show. He was out duck hunting this weekend. He had a life and death situation come up. They actually called for rescue. I mentioned in the last podcast, our schedules haven't meshed, but he called for rescue, had to come, had to have people come in and rescue them from their trip, lost one of their craft, lost a lot of their gear, but were able to live. You know, they got their lives out of it. And so
it's going to be a good story.
It's going to be a good story. And I think it's important to understand the when and the why. You know,
yeah.
When did they feel like, okay, because there was a bit, you know, I've heard the story. There was a brief moment in time where they felt like, oh, we could do this. We're not in danger. And then something clicked. They're like, we need help.
Yeah.
So that's important. And you have to recognize when you need help. We're going to cover this extensively, and it's going to be really cool to hear the story. And you guys are going to, you're going to be in for a special treat, and hopefully you learn something from it and can use that in your daily life or your hunting life. And realize that, you know, sometimes you need help and you just have to recognize early, the earlier, the better.
Definitely.
It would have made the difference for them, and they probably could have saved their boat too. So.
All right, everybody. Well, thank you for listening to the Ridgeline Hunting Podcast. And remember, if you want some game calls, turkey calls, actually any type of dang call.
Waterfowl.
Yeah, waterfowl.
Big time.
Hit up Phelps Game Calls. And then, if you're trudging around in the woods like I usually do and Dave does, and you come out, you know, with your gear all furry and gross, get your burr paw on, and it cleans up your gear really well. And before you go and throw it in the wash, and then it comes out as one giant pile of one cloth when you have like 8 different garments that you just threw in. And that's at burrpaw.com. But everybody, thank you for listening, and we'll catch you next time.
Have a good night.